So, Bobby, you had a piece in this past week on Huffington Post about Benghazi. And before we talk about that specific angle of it, you know, we know that the Republican National Committee has been running a promotional campaign, essentially, to its potential suckers, that you can become a Benghazi watchdog if you donate money to them. They're just, who knows, days away from perhaps are offering tote bags and coffee mugs. But this past week, the Democrats decided ultimately to engage in the next round of Benghazi hearings, which is now by a select congressional committee, as opposed to the Senate committee on Benghazi and the congressional committee on Benghazi that we've already been forced to sit through. And they have decided, instead of just sending someone like Alan Grace in there to show that this is a joke, and he's someone who obviously is a great litigator, could have questioned every single assertion that they make, or instead of boycotting the hearings, which I think they should have done, they have lent it a certain credibility, which now we inevitably have to address by actually showing up there. The first thing that's come out of this, Bobby, at least in terms of their, you know, assessing this on their own terms, and it's still unclear to me what supposedly is the mystery here that they're trying to get to the bottom of. But Representative Darrell Issa shot himself in the foot, it seems to me, last week, because he leaked a still classified State Department email that says that one of the first responses from the White House to the Benghazi attack was to contact YouTube to warn of the ramifications of allowing of the posting of an anti-Islamic video. Now, this is the story that the White House has been saying all along, that there was massive confusion because you had protests in about 15 cities on September 11th and 12th of 2012 because of this video, the release of this video. It was in Tunisia. It was in Algiers. It was in Morocco. It was in Egypt. It was in Libya. There was worry that it was going to be in Afghanistan. The White House thought it was the video in all of these cases, and they approached YouTube. And Darrell Issa doesn't even seem to realize that this debunks his own claim. But that's, again, taking it on its face value. You had a much better take, it seems to me, in the Huffington Post.
Well, all I did was, you know, every time that the modern Republicans do one of these hearings, whether it's on the IRS or whether it's Benghazi or, you know, there any of the other issues that they get all exercised about, rather than actually doing their job and you know, and doing some good things for our country. I look at what the Democrats did when they were in power. And, you know, and it's just striking. And this was, you know, so I did with this Huffington Post piece is I took an incident that was very similar to Benghazi, but much worse, which was when Reagan placed the Marines, 1,800 Marines in Beirut after the 1982 invasion of Lebanon by Israel in order to expel the Palestinian Liberation Organization. Israel went in there, a civil war ensued, and and we sent in, for a reason that nobody has ever been able to explain, but Reagan insisted on doing this, we sent in 1,800 Marines, including a group of about 350 Marines to guard the international airport in Beirut. He was asked not to do this by Caspar Weinberger, his own Secretary of Defense, as well as the Speaker of the House, Tip O'Neill, and many other senators, both Republicans and Democrats, on the Defense Committee and the Foreign Affairs Committee. And the reason they had trepidation about this, Sam, was that the previous April, this was in October of 1983, the previous April, what is that, 5 months before, there had been a bombing at the U.S. Embassy, a suicide bombing at the U.S. Embassy in Beirut, in which 63 people were killed. So we knew there were suicide bombers there. We knew that that the U.S. and anything about America was a target, and that there were tremendous resentments against us in Beirut. And And there was all these warring factions that, you know, and Reagan said this is going to be a peacekeeping mission. So he ordered the Marines not to load their weapons. So they didn't have any bullets in their gun. And he also ordered them to keep their war profile low. That was his quote. So they didn't build barricades around their barracks. They had plywood instead of sandbags stacked 20 feet high and fortifications and poured concrete and rebar and everything else. And they had local Lebanese army guarding the place, and they had two Marines, neither of whom had bullets in their gun. So at 6:42 a.m., a truck rushes in with a payload of 6 tons of high explosives and goes into the lobby of the barracks and detonates. It actually lifted the entire barracks off its fortifications. It was the largest non-nuclear explosion ever recorded by seismic devices, and 262 American service people, most of the Marines, were killed. And Reagan had been warned and warned and warned not to do this, that these were sitting ducks, that they were targets, and these were all words that were used in those public warnings. So that night, Reagan had a meeting in the West Wing of the White House, and all of these Senate and congressional leaders were brought there in secret through secret tunnels from the executive office building in separate cars. And Reagan gave this kind of bizarre speech. You know, he had said publicly, made a sort of glib comment saying, well, you know, yeah, this happened, but and they weren't adequately protected. But anybody who's ever done work on their kitchen can understand why that it, you know, when it doesn't get done on time or when it doesn't get done the way that you want it to get done. So that was his kind of glib comment. And then he met with them that night. And that night, he gives this speech about how we will never leave Lebanon. We will never be chased out with our tail between our legs until there's peace in Lebanon. And then he recited this story that Tip O'Neill considered apocryphal. He thought it must be from an old movie that Reagan had seen. But Reagan remembered the Filipinos greeting the Marines when they landed in the Philippines during World War II. So, and it was just, and finally, Tip O'Neill interrupted him. And he pounded the table and he said, the American people need to know why we're in Iraq. You need to explain that to them.
In Lebanon.
In Lebanon. And Reagan was so shaken by the violence and the anger in Tip O'Neill's response that he was just struck dumb. He literally couldn't speak. And Senator Howard Baker came over to him and patted him, and he said, sir, pointing to O'Neill, he said, he's on your side. He's trying to help you. So the upshot was that Tip O'Neill went back and met with the Democratic caucus the next day. They were up in arms and said, you know, let's go after him on this. He made a supreme mistake, and we should tar him for this. And he said, no. Everybody's going to hold their tongues. It's time for patriotism, not partisanship. We are going to wait until we get out of this before there's any public criticism from our party against him. And then, the kind of the punchline was that Reagan then ordered Caspar Weinberger to bomb the two Shiite headquarters in Beirut. Caspar Weinberger refused to do it. He just said no. He didn't say it directly to Reagan, but he refused to do it, and he withdrew all 1,800 troops from Beirut, and that was the end of it. Okay, skip forward 5 years, which was to 1988. Reagan now illegally gives 2,000 missiles to the terror state of Iran, which is illegal under the embargo that we led. It's illegal under U.S. law. We're not allowed to trade with the enemy. He's trading hostages, which set out, incidentally, it triggered a giant hostage taking all over the Mideast when people, when, you know, terrorists found out that they could get missiles by kidnapping Americans.
Hey, Bobby, let's take a break here and let's pick up with this story on the other side, because I think this is important to put this so people get a sense that it wasn't always this way with American politics. We'll be right back with more on this on the other side.